Gong.
Hey.
Hey, that's some moody lighting. I like it.
Trying to avoid any... this could look even worse. Look, I look now like
that's
I'm...
That's true. You could
I'm
be
being
shining.
Interrogated.
The interrogation is always fun.
What can I do? I might be able to turn a few on. Hold on. Who knew, right? We'd all be or have to become lighting experts.
Exactly.
There we go.
Vanity, thy sting.
Bright? Maybe I should do it up a bit. Is that better? No.
No.
That's really bright, isn't it?
It's a little bright.
Yeah. How can I? Maybe I can bounce it like that. You know?
Well, the original moody, dark look was not so terrible. Maybe Michelle.
Okay, maybe we just do that. Maybe I go back to where I was seated. And I turned on all this stuff behind me there. That's okay.
It's always tricky.
There you go. That's perfectly all right, isn't it?
Yes. It's lovely.
How are you? How have you been?
I have been okay. You know, this whole thing is a bit much. This COVID thing.
It's really starting to get a little bit boring now.
It's been a long time. Well, it's been
London
a long time.
London has just been sent into tier three, which over here means basically another lockdown.
And California's in one as well.
Yeah. So Sadiq Khan, our Labour elected mayor, has basically said that it's going to kill the London economy, possibly for another 20. I mean, if he shuts it down, there are all these arguments as to, because, you know, we've got like, hairdressers can stay open, hair salons can stay open, but pubs can't. Nail salons can stay open, but gymnasium, it's like, where is the sense in this? Here, you see, we have got it slightly more under control, I think. So there's this sense of exasperation that actually, are they just playing with us? Are they, like, where's the sense?
Well, LA's been pretty locked down for most of it. They've done a pretty good job, and yet, our numbers have been going crazy in the last month. So we can't quite figure out why. It's I guess people are just kind of getting too used to it and aren't wearing the masks in certain places or whatever. But it's we thought we had a handle on it, and yet the numbers have gone crazy. So,
but you know, I worry also that to me, as with so many other issues, what COVID really is doing is shining a light on the biggest problems that we know every society faces, which is education, bad food, you know, bad housing. Do you know what I mean? But all the things that people with no money have to resort to. You know, if you can feed your family on McDonald's for $5 a day, then you do. Those are the people, you know, if you've been eating that for 25 years, that's someone who's going to possibly get a respiratory disease, and it's going to be fatal. It's the same with, you know what I mean? So it's actually weirdly, it's shining a light in my mind on issues that have actually been and are always glaringly in front of us, things that we don't want to deal with. And now it's fatal, because now it's like, you know, if you are in this bracket, the elderly, how do we, you know, I don't know about the States, but the UK, you know, we handle the elderly, we look after the elderly terribly. And suddenly, you know, we're losing them in vast numbers in the homes. Because they're petri dishes for the COVID virus.
Well, it's an interesting, I mean, I was also talking about, you know, how people without money don't go to the doctor when they don't feel well, unless they really are in bad shape.
Right.
So that may be part of the reason why we're seeing such a large percentage of people of color and other poor groups not getting, you know, getting sick and dying because they're waiting till the last minute. It's too late. But
that's right.
We have states now where they're keeping people at home and just having them convalesce in their houses. So it's pretty bad in a lot of the country. It's weird. And then of course we have all the drama around our election has made it worse.
What was that? No, I'm just...
Yeah. It was like nothing happened.
Wow. I mean, the world's biggest strop. You know what a strop is?
I do.
Yeah.
Thanks
like
to Mr. Ritchie.
Biggest cough, like, my kids used to pull strops. I'd always be like, what? Don't pull a strop in the corner. Come on over here and face it, you know.
So what is your footprint like in America? Do you, I mean, obviously you come here to work, but do you spend enough time here that you feel like you have a real sense of the culture here, or do you try to avoid being here enough that you get a real sense of the culture?
No, not at all. I've had a wonderful opportunity over the years, past 20 odd years, to get to know certain cities and certain states, certainly. I mean, I think once you travel around the states, you realize the diversity of lifestyles in the different areas, in the different states, in the different cities. But I certainly feel like I've got a relationship with, LA, of course, and San Francisco a little, Chicago a little, New York quite a lot. New Orleans has become a very, very dear place to me. Not many others. So I can't say, oh yeah, I know it really well as a country. But I've loved my experiences there. And I think as with anyone who has a relationship or has worked there, and yet maybe lives abroad, but certainly feels that, you know, it's a place, maybe that is specific to Brits. I don't think it is specific to Brits, but I certainly feel, you know, it's like my second home in many ways. And that's not just because I was born during the sort of Thatcher Reagan special relationship era. It does have a sort of special relationship, the shared language. It was a culture. Well, funny enough, I think this is all applicable to the Nest in many ways, but it was the place that one looked to. What are they doing? What's coming next? What are we going to be influenced by? So it's always held that regard. And now I have, you know, relationships there, friends there.
We like to pretend we don't get influenced by England. You know, it's even though there's been enormous influence in this country from the UK, we pretend it was us. We acquire it and we kind of eat it instead of actually admitting it.
I mean, I always get slightly, it's funny to me, I guess, that the sort of Downton Abbey effect still has such sway in the States. There's a little part of you. I was actually doing one of a similar interview, and a brass band was playing, because I live around a square in North London, and a brass band was playing Christmas carols, and the person on the other end was like, hold on a minute, like, just, is that like, does that happen everywhere in London? You know, he had this picture of everyone in mufflers and scarves and snow falling and, you know, horse and carts,
yes,
clip-clopping by, brass band playing, of course. And I think there's always that sense, oh, we don't really live like that. But as for influence, well, I think it's a slight, yeah, I think the traffic goes slightly more one way than the other, don't you?
Well, we don't really send a lot of actors to the UK to become famous.
No. Exactly. There you go. There you have it in a nutshell.
Yeah. So I'm reading about you in preparation for this. I didn't realize that you were a kid actor. I mean, you started very young.
You know what? It's taken me into my 40s before I've really realized that is absolutely the case. Because at the time, I mean, I started when I was still at school, but even when I left school and went off to become an actor, professional actor, I was a boy. And yet I'd always assumed it was, I don't know, a kind of hobby for many, many years. Maybe that's the way I looked at it to keep myself sane. I don't know, but you're absolutely right. But it's taken me many years to sort of fully comprehend and appreciate that that's the case. I was 17 when I got, I mean, I was doing little bits and bobs. I was in a theatre company and I was doing little bits on TV here and there if I got offered a job, because it was something I loved doing as a child. But yeah, my first job was when I was 17, and I left school and left home and went off and became an actor.
So was there something drawing you to it, or was it really, of course, the idea is that you have your face, which we all have memorized over the years, which is overwhelming to certain people. I don't know if you've noticed that, But, you know, did somebody say, oh, you're beautiful, you should be in the movies? Or did you have a real passion for being on a stage?
I had a real passion. I had a mother and a father who were professionally teachers, but both sort of undercover actors and directors. And they were heavily involved in a local theatre company, amateur theatre company. And they did a lot of theatre. And I remember, you know, doing my homework in the back of this drafty theatre in Southeast London with my sister and nodding off while they were rehearsing Alan Ayckbourn plays and Willie Russell plays and all sorts. So I grew up pretty much in the theatre, and it felt always, sounds cliche and corny, but like a sort of home, you know? Mm-hmm. And I was always intrigued by it and loved the ferocious sort of dedication to it, that, you know, once the curtain goes back, you have to believe you, it's real. And it just became a language that I understood. And then at school, listen, I think children respond when they're told they're good at something. And I was told quite young that I was good at it. And so, you know, if you're good, you go, oh, okay, I'll do more of this. You know, it's no child's ever been told they're good at something and they go, right, I'll never do that again. You know what I mean? So I kind of followed my nose. And then, you know, my parents were very smart. They kind of fed that they took me to the theater a lot. They showed me a lot of films. I remember being shown all sorts of variety of films. By my mum was usually more sort of foreign films and art films, and my dad was more mainstream and commercial films, so I got an appetite for both. I just love the world. I like the democracy of it. I like the adults, and you know, I didn't feel like an adult, I didn't feel like a kid either, but it felt very democratic, that if someone had a good idea or if someone had a question, everyone listened. And it was never a case, or certainly not in my experience, of shut up and stand over there and do as you're told. It felt very egalitarian and creative and collaborative. And I loved that. And I think I always felt like I confident. I felt like, I remember watching stuff when I was little thinking I can do that. Or I can try and do that. And I've also, I suppose, if I'm honest, never been too uncomfortable with people telling me. I think there's a big line you have to cross as an actor, which is you've got to be ready for someone to say that didn't work, like try it again, without feeling defeated and destroyed by that. Mm. It's part of the process. And I've never felt beaten up if someone said, that wasn't good. Or why did you do it like that? Do it like this. I've quite enjoyed that. I thought, oh, okay, yeah, I get it. Let's get, it's a process, right? So let's get closer to what it is. And I mean, I looking back at myself as such a young kid in that environment, in that world rather, I really did love the art, the profession, the process. I liked studying, and I liked learning what it was they wanted from me. And if I'm honest, back then I was also excited by just the sort of freedom and the eccentricity of it, and the beautiful people around me. And then, you know, you get to an age where you suddenly really also realize, gosh, this is a craft, and this is a job where you have to make kind of big decisions in a way about what kind of work do I want to do and why do I want to do it. And but that all came later.
Did you always have that confidence in terms of the work? Have you had times where you weren't so sure?
I think the first big wobble I had was in my 30s. I think up until then, I sort of sailed through my 20s with confidence and a sense of certainty. And in a way that the question you just asked and the end of the last response I gave kind of married. I think suddenly I hit my 30s and it was my job. And I was known for it. And I had a family to support. And so you're making different decisions. You're not just sailing this wave going, riding this wave going, this is great. You know, because when I started out, I just wanted to do it. And I wanted to try as much as I could. And And I was riding a wave of confidence and a sense of curiosity and wide-eyed, you know, ambition and naivety probably. Mm. And then you hit this point where you think, gosh, okay, this is my job. And I need to earn a living to support my family. And B, I'm an artist and I want to make work that means something and that has an impact of sorts. And how do I, and what is this business? Because people always talk about the business, and there is indeed a business. You have to learn about the business and you have to understand that the business will play you and you must play the business. And So I think that was my first big wobble, where I sort of second guessed things, or I made decisions based on, let's just say I overthought things perhaps, or I had to apply a new way of decision making, and that took the wind out of my sails. There's a lot of sailing references going on, a lot of wind and rain and a wave. So I'm not a sailor, by the way, but
well, Mr. Ripley, you were. For a summer. Was that in the midst of the highs of success, or the midst of moments where there were challenges? Like, because you had a run of movies that were, you hit after success, after success, after success. People were loving you. And then there were, you know, some movies that just didn't work in terms of box office, and people weren't into it so much.
Was honestly, I can't remember specifically, but I think I wouldn't be surprised if I were to go back. I wouldn't be surprised if it came around the time that I suddenly realized that perhaps decisions I made hadn't been realized in whatever capacity, whether they were a success financially or critically or just fulfillment. I'm sure the two must have been married at some point. I think looking back, you know, the hitting the ground running the way I did and a swift ascent to an Academy Award nomination and notoriety, you when that happens to you at a young age, you do assume, and I'd be amazed if there was someone out there who said that they didn't, you do assume that it's just going to keep coming. You know, why wouldn't you? You think, okay, I'm on the right path here. And so the first time you sort of think, oh, they didn't like that, or oh, that didn't work, it rocks you, because you suddenly realize, oh, okay, no, this is a graph. Now, going back to answer your question, I don't know exactly when. I think it may have taken a little bit of time, but the way I like to look at it, I don't tend to look back much, and I don't tend to look forward much. I've spent a lot of my life trying in my private life to live in the moment. I think it's a much healthier way of being, certainly as an actor and actually as a human being. But I do think that I don't look at it as this sort of series of decisions made by, to be crude, a hit or a flop. Right. I think it was more me figuring out just how to weather the journey. There is no doubt in my mind that this is what I love doing and I want to be doing it when I'm an old man. So it's not a case of, oh, it's over, or, oh, I fail. It's a case of, oh, what's going on now? How do I get through this? How do I keep making interesting work? How do I work with the people I want to work with? Or, you know, how do I get through the next phase, or what's the best thing in front of me? So does that make sense? It's not like a case of me hitting a wall and going, what's just happened? It's a case of me kind of approaching things as they sort of come my way. And that, of course, keeps changing. My age affects that. The success or failing of my works affects that. You know, the demands on my life affect that. The demands on the industry affect that.
My question, I think, was aiming at the idea that sometimes when you're riding the height of the wave, you realize you're not in control, and that you kind of, you know, even though you're having a great moment, you also realize that you're not necessarily where you want to be.
I think that's very, very true. And I think it takes time to find a way. I took time to find a way of gaining that kind of control. Because you have to understand what the control is you want, I guess.
So what is it that drives you to, I mean, it's, well, what drives you to a movie? What drives you to make a choice to actually spend your time on this or that.
I feel like this answer has been the same for so many years, and I wish I could be more insightful in a way at this particular point and with you. It's always been who's involved, and are they going to be collaborative and team players? There are very few people I would overlook, whose personality I would overlook just to work with them for the hell of it. You know, I mean, you can be the greatest director on the planet, but if you're mean, I don't know that I want to spend any time sort of giving. Acting is a very naked, very revealing, vulnerable state, I think. And I like it to be a good place, a safe place to do that. It doesn't have to be a happy place, but it needs to be a safe place. So the people and a curiosity, something that I have to obviously get it. And it's funny, sometimes you look back and you realize, wow, you see something that maybe came your way or passed you by, and you get it when you see it and you think, how did I not get that? But if you don't get something when it's being explained to you and you don't understand what you can contribute or what they're looking to bring out of you, then you obviously you can't get involved in that. But then also, you know, I still have to make practical decisions. I think most actors do, when you have to weigh up the film you're going to do that you do for sort of back end, and then the film you do that you know will pay your mortgage and will allow you to go and do the film for back end. And I think those are healthy things to discuss, and they're important decisions to make for an actor. You know, you have to try and balance the two, and that's the whole, it's a business, and learning to navigate your way through that business is an important part of being an actor.
It's interesting that both of your Spielberg and your Scorsese experiences were on movies where that were giant for them. They were technologically challenging, yes, and probably didn't have as much intimacy as some of their other stuff in terms of working with the actors, or maybe I'm wrong about that.
Well, you know, with Steven Spielberg, it felt like a very it felt like a very hands-on experience, actually. He was incredibly generous, but also very interactive in the development and the nurturing of that character. And certainly on set, my memory, I mean, it's 20 years ago now, but my memory is that he was hugely involved in the minutest detail and encouraging in drawing out ideas and inspirations from all the actors. And with Marty, it was so I've done two small parts in his films, and both were big undertakings of his, and it, to be honest, they just felt like kind of, you know, wonderful, very 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 swift lessons in filmmaking for me, because both of them were really over about 3 or 4 days. So I didn't get a true taste of what the experience was that he was going through. I was just always a sort of visitor.
So what do you take away from directors? You know, you've worked with a pretty amazing list of high-end directors. Do you take away, do you watch them? Do you learn as an actor from them? Or are you just doing the gig in the moment and very focused, and then you're on to the next thing?
I've learned to realize that I have my own process, but my process takes place before I come to set. Like, I do a lot of work that I've changed and shifted over the years to suit me, so that I arrive feeling kind of ready and confident and thorough research is such an overused word, I think, by actors, but in the preparation. But what I love to be able to do is then, I feel like I'm a tool in a toolbox, you know, and the director is the mechanic. The director is the person building this machine or building this piece. And you have to be malleable. I've never been someone who says, oh, no, I don't do that, or I can't do it this way. I like learning. I like to say to the director, what do you want me to do? Like, what do I have to do to make this work for your film? and I'll have an opinion, but I've really enjoyed watching how these different directors approach the same medium. I've learned on reflection that every film is about the director making it. That they're ultimately all trying to sort of work out what it is through this particular story they're trying to say about themselves or about their life or about who they are. And I really enjoy being a kind of color on that palette. I enjoy the different approaches and I enjoy the different temperaments and the different demands. And I also, the older I get and the more I've worked with, I do enjoy this sense of curiosity. I'm no longer as servile and a lot more observant. Now I think it's much more, oh, you do it like this, huh? That's interesting. Well, you know, I can think of 10 ways to save time here, but I'm not going to say anything.
Are there directors who've been afraid to direct you too much? Or they get intimidated by you?
Gosh, I don't know. I hope not. I like to think I'm approachable. I certainly don't give off. I mean, I like to think I'm quite a team player. It depends on what the part's demanding and what the day is demanding. You know, some days you turn up and you know what you've got to do to get yourself to a place where you feel happy with what you've contributed. And sometimes the more people talk at you and tell you, oh, we're thinking of this, or are you okay? We need, you know, it's like, stop talking. Let me just do what I got to do. I know where I've got to get to. I don't think I've ever intimidated anyone to the point. You'll have to ask them. I don't think so.
Is there such thing as an easy role for you? Are there some of them that you just kind of do?
Yeah, that's a really great question. Easy roles. No, I think if you come away and go, oh, that was easy, I think you've really missed a trick.
Mm.
You've missed, you know, because the challenge, I guess, is to test yourself, make yourself, put yourself in a position where you're a little scared, or also just, okay, we've done the safe one, let's go crazy. What are we going to do to make this really interesting? It may be a waste of time, but let's just do it anyway. There are certainly roles that are pleasurable. There are roles that are more, you come away and you realize suddenly, oh, I like sitting in this skin. This person brings out a playfulness in me or brings out a sense of well-being. And there are other people whose skin is just grief-ridden or miserable. This series I did recently, The Third Day, was the case in point. Playing that man, Sam, was really hard. Playing a father who'd lost his child, I didn't enjoy getting into his head every day, and it just grew, it just chipped away at me. And I was very happy to see the back of him. And that's happened. Playing him recently, or maybe certainly at this point in my life, shone a light on that very point that you've just asked, actually. And it did make me reflect on other parts I'd done where I thought, oh yeah, I wasn't at my happiest playing that role. And it's probably because living and looking out of the eyes of that particular person wasn't a good experience.
So was Lenny fun? Because he felt fun from the outside.
Lenny was really great fun. Lenny was ordered. So I had this whole system of every person I encountered and how Lenny in a split second would deal with them. And there was a lot of that. If I remember rightly, I had like block, welcome, assist. And it was like a chess game. And what was great was, you know, people would come and you wouldn't even encounter them. You'd just block them like this and keep moving forward. So he was, I learned a lot about stillness as well. I just played, it was about a year before, but I played Henry V on stage. Mm. And playing a king, a young king in particular, you know, but a king in that period was really interesting, getting used to the effect of your presence amongst others, and the slightest move can mean everything. That, you know, you can rally an army by pointing or by moving people, you know. And I played along I followed that lead when I got into Lenny's skin, and I really relished the opportunity to investigate stillness. And then the playfulness was just drawn up and out by Paolo, who was, you know, talk about a director reflecting himself in his work. You know, Paolo's dreamy, eccentric qualities and his humor, and then also his soulful, philosophical, analytical qualities are all over his work. Mm. And Lenny is so him, you know.
Right.
It's no secret he grew up without a mother and father, and so much of Lenny's search emotionally was Paolo's.
And he loves a big frame with something moving quietly in the middle of it.
That's right.
Or around it. He also loves
orchestrating camera moves that look like they've been doctored, but actually it's usually making me, so I'll walk off there and then I have to pick up my skirts and run all the way around so that when he pans, I walk in another door and you watch it going, how do they do that? There must be a cut. No, that's me running around with my skirts up like this very, very quickly to get to the other door. He would come up with those all the time. And usually when I'm wearing like the biggest costume possible, I'm like, Paolo, how do you want me to sneak under the dolly out the door and back and then pop up in all, like, I can't. He's like, try for me, please, try for me.
And do you like that kind of challenge? Is that?
Oh, yeah. It reminds me of theater, actually, which I have a huge passion for. And yeah, but also this sense of capturing the moment. I mean, the cliche is, you know, the lightning in the bottle. It's wonderful that when you roll or when you turn over, you know, what you see is what you get. And if you're aiming for some sort of magic, then the magic has to, you know, every magician I'm sure will tell you that there's, you know, behind the perfect door, behind the perfect facade of sort of elegance, there's all sorts of, it's like the synchronized swimmers, right? On the surface they look perfect, you cut underneath and there's a lot of grabbing and thrusting and kicking, and you know, it's all of that going on.
What's funny, because Sean Durkin in The Nest, it feels like he's kind of constantly taking a bottle and shaking it, and then you're waiting to see the top explode, because it's always quiet before the explosion.
Yeah. It's interesting reflecting on his film, on the work we did, because there are sort of chapters to the experience. I remember reading this riveting script that had within it this character of the house. Now, obviously my eye was always drawn to this husband and his wife and the family and this really extraordinary naturalistic and detailed sort of journey and rather unusual journey, that there was no adoption or there was no death or there was no affair. It was about a family sort of just surviving. But this the presence of this house and this sort of gothic nature of this house that on the page actually was even more present. There were windows flinging open and banging and kids getting lost in there, like, hey, where am I? And then, you know, doors opening, I'm here, it's fine. A lot of that was toned down. But nonetheless, when you watch the film, you're aware of this. What I think he was getting at was exactly what you described, the pressure or the sense of foreboding, building and building and building, which really is a sort of metaphor, I suppose, or a physical embodiment of the family and the emotions in that house. The house is the bottle, right? And the family are the pop inside. I had more of my eye on the day-to-day drama because that was my sort of job. It felt always to ground it and find a truth. I feel like that's what Carrie and I were trying to do every day. But then this is the joy of, you know, you do what you're required to do and then you watch the film and you think, gosh, no, he's painted this in this world of sort of, it's kind of Friedkin-esque and, you know, in its darkness.
What's funny, I spoke to Carrie about the movie also, and I don't really get the house so much. I mean, I get it, but I don't, it's not my focus either. To me, it seems like it's two people who have managed through their lives to avoid reality in some level. And then suddenly they have to deal with reality. And both of them have found a way to reflect it and deflect it in a different way.
Yeah.
I mean, she was grounded in it and then gave up her grounding to take this, you know, ride in the circus. So she is angry in one, you know, she's hurt in one way. And then your guy is such a classic male journey of, you know, trying to hit that high and thinking you're there and thinking you're there and then realizing there's really no net beneath you, which is not all that unusual, you know, for middle
age. No, absolutely not. And yet I think it's hard to pick out. You're right that it's not unusual, but I think it's all the more extraordinary, therefore, that there aren't many. I think there's a sort of nakedness to Rory in Sean's film that you haven't seen before. This sense of, you know, blindness to what's around him, this drive, this absolute drive to just to band-aid everything up with more and more and more and more jazz hands all over the place.
Well, she is so exactly who she is. She is so, like, even though she's taken this ride, she's still the grounded person.
That's right.
Who was a waitress.
Yeah.
So she kind of forces Rory to open up to that in ways that he really, really doesn't want to. I mean, that sequence with the mother is amazing still.
So heartbreaking.
It is for both of them.
Yeah.
You know, and everything she doesn't say.
Yeah.
That she's also, it's quite remarkable.
Yeah. What amazed me about it was also how it's not like it took him. I mean, I'll say this, and if you were to talk to him, he'd probably tell you that, of course, the editing process was incredibly refined. And they were whittling away to the essence. But there's a sort of simplicity to his storytelling that was already in the script. You know, there wasn't any more than that one scene with the mother. There wasn't, you know, it was very sparse and very carefully considered in when the truths were revealed. Because if you remember, there's only one scene also with her mum at the beginning. Mm-hmm. And the mother sort of says, you know, you should be pleased with what you've got and sort of settle for it and, you know, and kind of get on with it in a way, which says just as much as this heartbreaking, icy scene over a cold pot of tea and a sandwich that you get Rory and his mother meeting over. But his storytelling is sparse and incredibly effective, I think.
And his the boss is kind of like a bad father who's finally getting around to telling him the truth, because he's not happy telling the lie anymore for whatever reasons.
No, that's right. But also not really in it for him.
No.
An interesting choice that he made, which I found really revealing, was when I read it and right up to the day he sent me a photo of the guy he had cast as the taxi driver at the end.
Mm.
I always assumed that the taxi driver was going to be this older gentleman, who would appear to be this sort of father figure that would give me advice. And then, of course, in order for him to threaten me to get out of the car in the middle of nowhere, he had to be young, but also the guy that played it was this quite tough, hard-looking guy. So the conversation was almost sort of therapeutic, where in a way Rory's just talking aloud and doesn't realize that perhaps for the first time he's been honest. And of course, the response that you get is this young guy saying, you just told me who you are and I don't want you in my car, get out, you know. But
in some ways, it's the kindest thing that happens to Rory in the movie.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Because he's willing to say, fuck you, get out, go walk it.
That's right. Could be the most important thing that happens to him in his life. Yes, that's a very good point.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like that guy.
Yeah. What an interesting thought that you know, those people that do that to us can be fleeting, and it can have these incredible effects on us. And at the time, we think of it nothing more than, oh, this person told me that, like, the shop was shut, or they told me to, you know, stop bothering them and leave, you know. And actually what it's done is it's pointed you down a new path and stopped you relying on the old tricks, dwelling on the old, on the past, you know.
Mm. I always think of the Mamet line from Glengarry, mm. where he says, Pacino in the movie says, you know, it's not the sex, it's not the orgasm, it's that feel of the woman's hand on the back of your neck, just for that moment, the way that feels. And that's what you stay with you forever. Mm. It's never the thing that's the big thing. It's those little things that are very subtle that stick with you forever.
I think that's a wonderful description, actually, of what Sean has the ability of capturing in his films. I think he's very good at whittling down to a small gesture, but a seismic gesture in your life. You know, I think he did the same. His attention to detail in his first film, Martha, Marcy, May, Maylene, was extraordinary at times. It was almost like memories, you know, fleeting memories. But to achieve that as such a young filmmaker is really extraordinary. I think he's going to make brilliant, brilliant films as he gets older.
Yeah. I felt like in Marcy that you never really knew why you were feeling the way you were feeling about it. Like it was so not story driven or character or plot driven. And it really was like watching a memory and
wasn't it?
Other people's memories.
Yeah, other people's memories. That's right.
Yeah.
But you know, I wonder if there's a relationship here, but I was so worried for her. I was so worried for her. And she felt so vulnerable. And yet, you know, I've seen films about cults that have been so much more explicit and so much more demonstrative. But I was so worried about what she just said. She was just so vulnerable. And what was, he was so clever was he showed her in normality rather than, I mean, obviously they went back, but he showed her how vulnerable she was because she was so dysfunctional in a normal setting. So you suddenly thought, well, what were they doing? In a setting where the rules had all changed.
Yeah.
And the one big note I had when I started The Nest, actually, with Rory, I don't know why this is related, I think it is, but was that I read the script. I remember I called him up and I was like, look, this is a really wonderful piece, but this guy is horrible. I hate him. I hate, you know, he was so unlikable. Then we sat for an afternoon the first time and just, I kept going through trying to say, he can't be that horrible to his kids. Like, he can't, like, beat them at football and tell them, you know. And then, and it's how you looked at it as opposed to, you know, reading it as it was, or I guess what you imbued it with, that changed the whole tone. Mm. And I kept having to think, Robert Redford can play this part. Like, he had to come over, like, you know, attractive and dashing, and because otherwise she was an idiot, right? She's not an idiot. Alison stays with him. She's with him thick and thin. She loves him. And it's not like just because he's got loads of money and obviously they're attracted to each other. There's a vitality there, but he had to be seductive. And I think that was the key. I thought, if I don't seduce the audience as well, then they're just going to go, no, I'm not coming along with this.
Yeah. Well, the character is exciting. You know, the guy you want to be at the party with it.
Yeah, good. Yeah, he's interested, even if it's bullshit. Right.
You know it's bullshit, but you want to hear it anyway.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, God. Like,
yeah, that's how I've always felt about Michael Moore. he is so completely full of shit a lot of the time, but he is the most sincere man. And you just, like, he's fun to hang out with because of that. So
I think we can come up with more than one example of that.
Oh, yes.
That you and I dabble in.
No doubt. The great bullshitters of Hollywood are.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
Yeah.
So entertaining.
But the ones you don't know, you can't tell whether they're bullshitting. That's the one that's really scary. It's funny because the thing is, you know, I've been doing this for a long time now. So there's a backstory for everything. And I know too much about certain things, people and their histories, and I've had histories with people and whatever. And it's, you know, you don't say it out loud because it's so impolite to do it to somebody, you know, you'll pull the rug out from somebody, but it's like you watch these redesigned stories of their lives and how they've, you know, repurposed what their high school career was like when I know what their high school career was like. And it's like, okay,
you just made me think of something. The way you described that made me think about the way one has to sort of change how you choose work in my profession. And I think a lot of it is trying to work out, and it's in many ways an unnatural process, but it's like, how am I perceived? What's known of me already, both as an actor and possibly even as a person, like even though that person isn't me, but this, you know, and how can I keep that interesting? And how can I mine that? Or how can I run away from that? And that's a really interesting area, but you have to be aware of it, I think, because otherwise, you know, if you still think, oh, everyone thinks of me the same as when they saw me at 26, that you're a fool, right? You have to change. But you also have to think, what might they want me to see me doing? Or what do I want to see this person do? You know, you have to be thorough and honest about it. But you have to remember, the reason you made me think of that was, you also have to remember the backstory. You have to remember the story you've told or the story that's being told so that it makes sense.
Well, I got to say, there's nobody in this business who I love who I don't know somebody who's told me they're an asshole. And I don't know an asshole that I think is a jerk, you know, who I don't know somebody who thinks they're great.
Yeah.
So you can't control other people's perception, particularly when they won't tell you. I know that I personally am a bit of a victim of that in my industry because I criticize journalists and they all hate it. They're the thinnest skinned people in the world. And so I'm a prick to some people to the point where they don't want anything to do with me, which is, you know, I feel almost as a compliment, but you know, wherever I actually think I am, I have to be the one to ground it because I can't trust anybody else outside of my household.
That's right. You know?
So you went back in the midst of some of the heat of your success to the theater. You did Hamlet and you did Henry V. And I think there was one other show you did in there.
Eugene O'Neill play. I did Anna Christie.
Yeah. So was that a recovery of something? Was it just the mood that you felt the urge to go do it, or you were getting too old to do Hamlet if you didn't do it quickly? Or
all those points. I am an actor who started in the theater, and therefore I see myself as a theater actor, and it's certainly the place I fell in love with acting, and I feel nothing can replace the adrenaline and the physical response you get from putting on rehearsing and then putting on a play. And it had been a long time. And Hamlet came up in a conversation and as an idea for me to be a part of. And as you rightly pointed out, I was at a, I think I was just on the other side of 30. And we worked out that actually it was a safe age. You still wouldn't be an old Hamlet. And once I sort of started, once I went through that experience, I'd rekindled not just a sort of the love and the familiarity with the process, but also with particularly with Michael Grandage and the Donmar. And once Michael got his teeth sort of into the idea of me doing more, we had numerous conversations, and Rob Ashford, who directed the Anna Christie, is a great friend of Michael's, and so that's how that happened. And then Michael came back to me and said, look, we've done one, we should do Henry again before you're too old. And and a lot of the cast were the same, so it was a wonderful sense of sort of keeping this team together. All of that was over about 10 years though, well, maybe less than about 8, but it wasn't in my mind some big return. It wasn't a case of, oh, I've forgotten, or it was a case of when rather than if. And the same applies now. I mean, actually, it's always in the back of my mind. And I'm certainly someone who hopes, you know, I said to you before about becoming an old man and still acting. I love the idea of playing. It was Derek Jacobi told me that, you know, You have to jump through the hoops of Hamlet, Henry, Coriolanus, and then you get to, you earn King Lear, you know, but you can't get there without, you have to sort
you of, really haven't had a Hamlet on in terms of your film career. That character is really not anything that I can recall that you're playing somebody that confused, I guess, or the complications.
Yeah, you have. I mean, goodness, who gets to play Hamlet like, or an equivalent on film? But you're quite right. No, I haven't gone anywhere near it, but I think.
And Henry also, by the way, Henry V, that kind of exuberance and pure, I don't know how you played it exactly, because I haven't seen it, but the passion of that character,
yeah,
is, again, not something that they tend to hire you for to do in movies.
No, it's true. It was I had a very interesting experience this year, actually, when the live event that I was doing in the middle of the third day, which was being shown on HBO, was going to be a piece of theatre that turned into a live theatre stream. And it was the first time I realised that, in a way, an audience who was maybe used to seeing me on film was actually, in a way, seeing a theatre performance. And even though it was filmed, this sense of never being off camera and being lost in this sort of truth, the physical truth of the moment, which is, I've learned through that experience, sort of closely rooted to what theatre is, and the physicality of the part, was, I was really pleased I was able to sort of combine the two, because, as I said, I think it was the first time possibly people used to seeing me on screen saw a little bit of what I do on stage, and vice versa. But you've sparked my desire now to go and look at why I'm not playing parts like that on film. I don't know. I mean, here's the thing. I've never been very good at answering the question, like, what do you want to play, or who do you want to play? And maybe I should be more proactive in that. I mean, I like developing stuff and I like approaching people, but I tend to sit back and wait for things. And then by doing that, in a way, you, I suppose, are at the mercy of how other people perceive you.
Yeah. No, it's hard. It's interesting because the wave of female directors and writers lately are all very, very driven to define themselves. In my experience, mm-hmm. and talking to them, mm-hmm. it's fascinating how kind of this, they're all kind of like connecting like a beehive almost, you know, like they're adding to it. And you can see that that's one of the reasons why you're beginning to see more films that are being made by them and getting financed and distribution, because they have that focus. On the other hand, you're quite well known, and people, I guess, want, you know, not everybody gets called for this Dumbledore,
no.
But you did.
Yeah.
So was something like that just fun? Is that a hard?
Oh, no, it's a big responsibility. I mean, they're great fun to make. I've never, you know, I think it's rare, you know, it's wonderful having at your, literally at your fingertips, the opportunity to dream up magical ways out of situations. You know, you can be in a scene in a dark room and say, oh, can I like click my fingers and turn on all the lights? And yeah, you can, because you're a really powerful wizard. You know, little yeah, one, yes, exactly. Or you just clap your hands twice. But it's a big responsibility. You know, he's so precious and respected by so many people, love this character. And complicated. He's a complicated character. And I think, quite rare experience to go back and play someone in their youth to try and put together and demonstrate the journey that he goes on to become the man that everyone loves. And I think David Yates and David Heyman have done a brilliant job with these films. Just managing to balance the fun, the spirit of magic, but also this drama of real people dealing with quite major issues.
Mm.
So it is fun and it's a lovely team, but I do take it quite seriously, because I think he's, you know, if you put him up there, he's like a kind of Falstaff, isn't he? Or a Prospero. I mean, he's a big, weighty historical character, and you can't walk into those and just say, oh, where's my wand? You know.
Well, some people do.
I guess you can.
Do you have? Is there any Richard Harris in your Dumbledore, or is that?
Of course.
Just slide it all in there.
I keep trying to picture what would my accent be if Richard Harris had brought me up.
It's hard. I don't know many people who've gotten to play the younger version of somebody who was played by two different actors.
No, I know. It gets very confusing. Very confusing.
Very confusing.
Yeah.
Do you like this? But besides the character itself, does the size of a show like that, is that part of, does it change your lifestyle? Does it feel any different than being on a set like the Durkin set where it's
obviously... Oh, of course. Yeah. But, you know, they are both equally as enjoyable, but for completely different and in completely different ways and for different reasons. You know, turning up, I remember, so the scene we discussed before in the nest when I get out of the car, originally the walk through the fields wasn't in the script. Mm. And we had this conversation and I kept saying, I really think we need to see how he gets home. You know, it should be hard. That's the journey, you know. So, you know, on a film that size, it was as simple as, you know, Matthias, the director of photography and the operator, Sean, the sound guy, about three other folk. We met in a field at 3 a.m. just near the set, and we just filmed, you know, and we filmed until the sun came up. And being able to do that in the freezing cold, but it didn't matter, and the light was beautiful, and Matthias is filming and directing and saying, like, hey, that way, this is beautiful, the lights are, you know, being able to throw yourself into that with that kind of passion and people around you who are as passionate and as committed is fantastic. You can't do that on an enormous film. However, turning up at Leavesden and shooting on this rebuilt, I mean, they created, I don't think I'm giving anything away, you know, 4 large intersections in Berlin with trams and cars and hundreds of extras and shops that if you go into, they're, you know, you're surprised there's no one actually in there serving you. The detail in all the shop fronts and all, you know, and you stand around on a film set like that and think, this is like old-fashioned movie making. This is huge and beautiful. And again, the artistry, but on a different scale.
Yeah.
It's phenomenal. So aren't I lucky? I mean, to be able to dip into both those worlds, different passions, different commitments, but and different scales, obviously. But both just as inspiring and both just as heartwarming.
Well, you do seem to like to work.
I do. Your schedule
is pretty full. There was a point at which it became like a comedy thing that you were in a lot of movies in 2000 and whatever.
I remember that. But I think it was a comedy thing.
But you still make a lot of movies.
Gag. Well, I make a lot, but I mean, I don't think I make any more than most. I think, you know, I do like to work. There's a reason I have to work. I have a big family and I like supporting them, and I'm whilst I do very, very well for myself, I'm not in the category of those who are, you know, able to buy small countries. I'm curious and I feel happy at work. Having said that, you know, it's interesting because actually as I say that, I feel like the luckiest person alive that I also get to have time off with the family. And I think if I were to reflect, you know, I've often been the dad at the school gates more frequently than most, actually.
Are you a different father at this age than you were 20 years ago?
Oh, good Lord, yes. Yeah. I'm going to go back to my surfing metaphors. I was talking about this with my daughter the other day, who's 20 now, and she was over with me and my new little, and I was laughing at how I said, she was like, were you the same? Were you just like this with me? And I said, I think so, you know, but it was such a wave. I was young and we were just doing it. Me and your mum were just doing it. And with this time around, I'm kind of looking at it all with such profundity. I'm like, wow, this is, it's like I'm looking at it slightly slower with almost through a lens. Like, this is extraordinary. Yeah. This little life form. Mm.
Well, I only have one kid, unlike you, but I have at 50, 45, I had the kid. So
good age though, I think.
it's been a joy for me. I mean, I got to say, yeah. I've loved every range of it, every moment of it for this kid. But I would imagine very different than doing it at 20. I understand why people do it at 20 and 25.
Yeah.
There's something where you're stupid enough to not worry about it so much.
Absolutely. And bouncing up at 5 a.m., you know, if you just did the night feed at 11, no problem. That's a little harder this time. There was a moment. There was that first weekend where you suddenly say, oh, yeah, weekends aren't off. Oh, yeah. Damn.
Turn to diapers.
Yeah.
That was the greatest moment, I think, maybe of my entire life, was when he stopped using diapers. And I was like, oh, okay.
Yeah.
Potty training is everything, yes.
All that stuff, just move it out.
Mm. Yeah. Whole different range of stuff, though, at 20. When they get, I don't have a girl, so I feel a little safer somehow. Feels a little less dangerous going into the teenage years.
I don't know, mate. I don't know.
I guess they're all difficult.
Minefields all over the place. Minefields all over the place, I said, with all of any human being, I think.
That's true. Well, just trying to anticipate what they'll be 3 years from now, 6 years from now. And it seems impossible to really know, and because they change so much, but it's exciting. It's interesting.
I'm going to say something now that probably won't make any sense if we go right the way back to the beginning of this conversation. But I mean, what I keep trying to say to my kids is, you know, everyone keeps asking you to make decisions. You don't have to make them yet. Like, you know, take on what's in front of you, you know, do these exams, give it your everything, and then we'll decide what. But then, you know, what's ironic is I was like, I know what I want to do. I want to do this, and I'm going to do it. And, you know, so I guess in a way I'm giving false advice, but you know, that
you're sense a terrible of, example, because you did so well doing that.
Yeah, maybe. I could have been a great concert pianist. Who knows?
Was that, did you play the piano?
No. That was me plucking something. I could have been an astronaut, you know.
I don't know. It's fun. I talked to a lot of people and they're like, yes, you know, they made that turn.
Yeah.
And they had something they could have, you know, that would have been the other thing maybe, but.
Yeah.
Who the hell knows?
This was it. This was it. I played my one card and I was very lucky.
So with as busy as you are, is it this mixture of things that you like the best? Is this the ideal? I know you don't look forward too much, but is the ideal thing this kind of, you know, if I feel urge to go to theater, I'll go to theater. If I feel the urge to do a big movie, I can do that. I'm very fortunate.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, you know, not all, you know, it depends what's available and what comes my way. I think the opportunity of really stretching in different directions going back to what I said before, if I'm curious and if it's seems exciting and interesting, then absolutely I'll go. I love this feeling of being pushed and pulled in all different directions by the parts of the demands of it. Yeah.
And do you, in terms of what you take away, and I guess I'm thinking specifically now of Karenina, because that movie got slaughtered by critics, didn't really get an audience or whatever, but it seemed like the experience of making that must have been fascinating, because the way he presented it, the way he did it, it was something that, you know, nobody really does. There are not other opportunities to do that.
No, exactly.
Is that what you walk away from? Is that I had the moment on the stage that was great for me and I can't really control the outcome?
Absolutely. And you have to look at it like that. You have to look at it like that going in. And then you probably can't work out what you took away from it for a few years, in my experience. Mm-hmm. But I certainly look back on that particular experience from when, obviously remember when we met and talked about that I remember that as a wonderfully liberating experience as an actor. I loved the creative liberation, freedom on set. I loved the opportunity of working as a kind of company on a film, which is very unusual. It felt like a sort of little operetta company that was making a film on stage, but it was with very obviously cinematic structure and organization. And I loved where working with a friend I loved where he was able to take me. He took me somewhere that I've probably gone back mind in various ways since. A sort of simplicity and a faith in the pool of in that case sadness and loneliness, rather than, you know, demonstrating it, sort of sit on it and let it be you. You have to show it. I remember that was a big sort of eureka moment working with, and I think I with Joan, I think I got there because I was with someone I was so comfortable with. You know, it was really interesting working with a director, a great director, but also a friend who I kind of knew better socially than I did professionally. And I've definitely gone back on that experience and used it as a sort of blueprint since.
It's funny, mentioning the perspective of time, I always say that Soderbergh's movies, I love his experimental, people assume it's a specific thing, but the movies where he didn't quite answer the question, but then I see how it shows up in the next movie or two movies later or three movies later. And so there's a glory to being able to see that on screen permanently, like a movie like The Underneath, which is murky and weird colors and all this stuff that ends up being very instructive in The Limey. You know, the masterpiece that is The Limey probably wouldn't exist without The Underneath. And it's one of the things that's great about Steven, that he keeps making those experiments.
That's right. And isn't that's a wonderful reminder to all of us as film goers that you know, it is a work, the whole thing is a work in progress and one informs the other, but also that, you know, we've got to stop viewing films as the perfect film or a good film, bad film, that, you know, films are a journey, films are a question, films, and that flaws in films often mean that it's breaking down some kind of boundary or challenging us as a viewer. But I love that as a sort of relationship where you relate one to the next, to the next, to the next. I think that goes back to this point that films are all really about the director making them. And you sit, it's why retrospectives are so enjoyable, and you get to see on screen, you know, a single director's work from beginning to end.
Well, you also see it in actors, I think, in a lot of actors, not every actor.
I think you do see it in actors too.
But you see it in actors over time. You definitely, who they are shows up.
Yes.
Because it's so unavoidable on film. On stage, you can do whatever, but on film, with that close up, you can't avoid who you are.
Yeah.
So you got to live with it.
Where do you keep going back to?
Yeah. Well, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
For staying up and doing this in your very modest basement without any awards or anything. I'm looking for Aaron Sorkin's Emmys behind you.
No, I've moved them. That's all. It's been fun and nice catching up.
And with you. And congratulations on the baby.
Thank you. Thanks so much.
It's a little insane to have a baby your age, but that's part of the fun of it. All of my friends thought I was crazy when I did it. So
yeah,
now it's your turn. But you have a little more experience than I do. Exactly. But you look good. That's the thing.
I've got all these other beautiful kitties to look after her, you see. Just pass her on. No, not really.
There you go. Hand off the football.
Thank you.
Have a lovely evening.
Happy holidays and a happy
holidays
year.
To you. Merry everything.
See you safe and sound in 2021.
And God, I'm so looking forward to 2021.
Yeah, me too.
It's got to be better than this.
Right.
Hey, what are you?
The only way is up, indeed. And out. Okay. Take care.
Take care.
Bye-bye.
Bye.